Hello everyone, welcome to our channel Neuromatics. Here we will discuss the basics of neuroanatomy as continuation of lecture 1. So don't forget to subscribe this channel and stay connected for further videos. Now I am going to discuss about the motor peripheral nervous system. As we already know that the function of motor peripheral nervous system is to take the information from the central nervous system to the peripheral parts of the body. And the motor responses that are coming from the motor peripheral nervous system are of two types. Number one is somatic or voluntary motor responses, and number two is autonomous and involuntary motor responses. Okay, first talk about the somatic motor responses. Those motor responses that are under your control or under your will are called somatic motor responses. And those motor responses that are not under your control and that are not under your will are called autonomic or involuntary motor responses. Here is the diagrammatic representation of the motor peripheral nervous system. As we already know that the motor peripheral nervous system is divided into two components, voluntary or somatic motor responses. Number two is involuntary or autonomic motor responses. The autonomic system, that is the part of the motor peripheral nervous system, is again subdivided into sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system, that we will discuss later. Let's talk about the voluntary or somatic motor responses. These are those motor responses that are under your control or under your will. Let's talk about the example of voluntary or somatic motor responses. For example, when you want to talk to your friend, is it under your control or not? Obviously, yes, that's under your control. So this is a voluntary or somatic motor response. In the similar way, there is another example. When you want to eat something, for example, when you want to eat a chicken piece and you put that chicken piece into your mouth, that's a voluntary action because it is under your control. But once that chicken piece goes into your stomach, can you tell your stomach, don't digest it today, digest it after 2 weeks? No. Yet it works as it won't. So it's not under your control, right? So this is involuntary or autonomic. Let's talk about the autonomous and involuntary motor responses. As you already know that those motor responses that are not under your control or will are called autonomous or involuntary motor responses. For example, the motor responses which cannot be controlled, like secretions of glands which cannot be controlled voluntarily, or movement of small muscles and respiratory process and heart rate, are not under your control. So these are involuntary motor responses. So we can simply call them autonomic motor responses, right? So all we learn here is that all the motor responses are categorized as voluntary or involuntary motor responses. Voluntary motor responses are also called somatic, and involuntary motor responses are also called autonomic motor responses. Example of somatic motor responses is movement of your hand, right? The breathing process, the breaths that I and you are taking all the time and right now, are examples of involuntary motor response. There is another example of involuntary and voluntary motor response. For example, if you see a doll and you decide to run away to protect yourself, and now running is your voluntary response, and with that your heart rate also goes up, that is involuntary. So to keep in balance, both systems are working. Right, let's go in detail about the autonomous nervous system. Autonomous nervous system is further divided into two parts, sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. When you are sitting comfortably, like right now, there is some sympathetic activity in your body and some parasympathetic activity. For example, if you go under stress, sympathetic activity will also goes up. And if you are very comfortable, parasympathetic activity will dominate in your body. So both of these systems are working in a coordinated way to keep your body in balance. Let's talk about the sympathetic nervous system first. Sympathetic nervous system will activate in situations like fight, flight, or fright situation. Let's take the example of sympathetic nervous system as I already discussed it previously. For example, when a dog is chasing you, right? One thing is that you run away. That is a voluntary action. But sympathetic nervous system automatically increases its activity and heart rate goes up. Blood vessels to skeletal muscles also dilate and vessels constrict. So blood should be diverted to the skeletal muscles, right? When dog is after you and you are flying away to protect yourself, what about your GIT activity? It should also go down. So what really happens there? The sympathetic nervous system knows which organ activity should be enhanced or which organ activity should be decreased. For example, cardiac activity will go up and GIT activity will go down under stress. Opposite to that, when you are not under stress and you are very comfortable, the sympathetic activity also goes down and parasympathetic activity goes up. And as a result of that, heart rate decreases and GIT activity increases. So this was a very brief introduction that what is the CNS, what is the PNS. We already know that the PNS is having sensory nerves which are taking information to the CNS, and PNS also having motor nerves that are taking information from the CNS to the peripheries. And then we have discussed the CNS has brain and spinal cord. Now I'll discuss about the structural classification of the nervous system. But before going into detail, we will discuss some basic terminologies of the nervous system, like what is gray matter and what is white matter. So first talk about the gray matter. Collection of cell bodies within the central nervous system is called gray matter. And collection of axons within the central nervous system is called white matter. Now we will discuss in detail about the structural classification of the nervous system through diagram. As we know that the nervous system is divided into two parts, central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Here we will discuss about the structural classification of the central nervous system, which is divided into two parts, gray matter and white matter. Gray matter, which is further divided into two parts, cortex and nucleus. So what is cortex? The part of the gray matter which is applied on the surface of the CNS is called cortex. And the pieces of the gray matter that are embedded in the central nervous system and are surrounded by white matter are called nuclei. In the similar way, white matter is divided into three parts, tracts, mesial fibers and association fibers. Those parts of the white matter that are connecting the central nervous system up and down or caudally and cephalically are called tracts. And what is mesial fibers? These are those fibers that are connecting the CNS, right side of the CNS with the left side, and left side of the CNS with the left right side are called mesial fibers. And now what is association fibers? Association fibers are those fibers that are connecting the central nervous system anterior posteriorly. These are called association fibers. So this was all about the basics of neuroanatomy. Thanks for watching this video and stay connecting with us for the next videos. So thanks for watching this video and stay connected with us for further videos. Thank you.